Thank you. Okay, so my name is Jaro de Vrede. As you said, I work at Quintor. You can visit us here at the stand. We're here all day, so cool. This talk actually started about 10 years ago when my dad was passionate about his old movies, but his projector gave out. So, well, we still wanted to watch the old movies, but well, we needed to digitize them because the old movies would fade over time because it's an analog, it's film, it would degrade the longer you keep it in your storage. So he built his first rig about 10 years ago, and a few years back he needed to rebuild it because he moved and, well, there was some new cool tech out there, like a Raspberry Pi, which could actually control the motors and sensors that we were using. The previous version was using LTDP for controlling motors, but, well, most computers nowadays don't have LTDP anymore, so a Pi came in. And he actually switched to Java, thanks to me, because Java is my programming language that I use at Quintor. Nowadays, actually, is Scala, but, well, still a big Java fan. So for those who don't know anything about 8mm, these are the things that people took movies with around, I think, the 50s to early 90s, I guess. And actually, they put a cassette in the recorder, and, well, they developed it to a film roll. And, well, they called it 8mm film because the film was 8mm wide. Well, we get a little bit more into details later on. But as you can see, it's an open film, so don't keep it in the light because then you will lose your film within a few weeks. So, what he was talking about a projector. Well, these are huge machines that actually project those 8mm films onto a big screen in your home. The screens were about a meter wide or something, so, well, it's something that a normal TV could handle. 1080p, well, that should be good enough. So, let's see how we can do that. But first, what the hell did they record back then? Well, some scenery in 1965, and this is Delft, actually. Or, a little bit later, actually, this is one of my first cats in 1982. I wasn't even there yet, but she was. So this is the actual movie that we're going to digitize in this presentation. Well, if you wanted to do it yourself, well, you could buy something like this. It will set you back around $5,000, and for every type of movie, you would need to buy an adapter of another $500. So if you have the money, go for it. If you don't, well, you could buy something from Wolverine. It's the digital movie maker. It could digitize both Super 8 and Single 8. We'll see the difference in a bit. And we'll set you back about $300. So, good price range. Quality is not that good, but, well, it's not that bad either. So you could do this. Especially if a lot of movies and you don't want to invest in a big rig, this is a way forward. But that's not the way we did it. We took a few steps. First, we wanted to build a rig and execute and control it. Then we wanted to divide the movie into film strips, because a scanner is quite slow and you need to position it quite precisely, so we want to scan a lot of frames and then divide it up again. So we call that film strips. And then create the raw movie of those frames, clean it up a bit because it's an old movie, so some colors are faded and we can actually correct it a little bit. And then we finally can enjoy our movie. So first step. This is our rig. Actually, it's running in action. On the left side, you can see the full spool. And when the scanner is done, it will actually pull the spool through on the right side because there's a little motor controlling it. And we use an opto-interrupter. That's a little sensor that can detect holes in the strip to see when we need to stop the motor. Actually, this is sped up very much because what you're watching is about 17 minutes. In 7 seconds, so we're halfway through, half an hour through here. So this is quite cool, but if we go to the next slide. So when we have our rig running, we can actually start to scan our strips, and this is the end result. On the left side, you can see Single 8, and on the right side, you can see Super 8. There's a little bit of difference in there. If you look closely, Single 8 is the old format. It's it has the hole on top of the frame, and single Super 8 has the hole in the center of the frame. Just the format change and the actual width and dimension of Super 8 and single 8 are a little bit different. I was talking about 8mm films. Well, it's not 8mm of film, it's actually only 5.8mm wide, because 8mm was the full film, including the hole, including a little bit on the side. So you're left with a very small and tiny picture. So if you want to use or watch the movie on a full HD screen, and I think still it is possible, because we scanned it in a little bit less of a quality, and finally we bumped it up, and we could still see some quality change in some movies, not all, but on the good preserved ones, we did see some change. So we went for the bigger format. If you want to convert it, it's around 8600 pixels per inch. Not something a scanner can do, because it goes from 4800 to 9600. So we scanned it a little bit bigger than full HD, but well, it works. We can downsize it. So how do we scan? Well, we'd use Java. So we'd use a library called jfreesang. Who here programs in Java or uses Java? Not that many. So I'm sorry, I'm going to show you some code. Well, this is Java. Actually, this is how you access the scanner. First of all, you connect to your local host, which is a bit odd because the scanner is connected to a USB port. But hey, this is how it works. Well, you get the devices, and well, we only have one device, so you get the zeroth element. You set some properties, what the resolution is, where to start scanning, to where, and that kind of stuff. And then you could call acquire image, and then we get a buffered image. Well, the buffered image is very important to us because that's a format we can use in Java to actually random pinpoint pixels in that image. So that's what we want. That's what we get. Cool. Good stuff. Only problem is the Raspberry has only a gigabyte of RAM. Fine. But the Raspberry Pi uses 80 megabytes of RAM for itself, for the operating system, and well, it's very minimalistic, but hey, we only get a 1 gigabyte. So if we call acquire image, we get a film strip, because it's that high of a resolution, of 560 megabytes. It's a bitmap, it's, well, it's just a big ass array of integers. And well, acquire image does that. But we want a buffered image. So this fits into memory just fine. But the buffered image is not what the software uses. It uses an internal format. So it's actually converted on the fly into a buffered image, which also is 560 megabytes. See our problem here? That doesn't fit. We could use swap. Cool, but a Raspberry Pi is using a SD card, which is not that fast, but you can use an external drive, but well, it's not cool as well. So we want to optimize this. So let's debug a little bit. Also, sorry, again, Java. The first thing it does is gets the image size, how much do we need to scan? And then it creates a byte array of that image size. So we have here now a byte array of 560 megabytes. And it just starts reading and filling up that byte array. Cool. But that's not a bitmap or a buffered image. So we changed it a little bit and created a array of only 550 megabytes. And what we first did was write the dimensions of what we scanned, because well, that can vary a little bit, depending on what format you're scanning and well, maybe some later insights. And first write it to a file. It's similar like a bitmap format, but hey. And then we start reading only that 50 megabytes. When we're done reading, we're actually going to flush that 50 megabytes into a file and just append it to that file. When we're done with that 50 megabytes, we then start to close the array and, well, just start up a new byte array and just fill that up until you're done scanning. So this way, we're only using 50 megabytes. So that saves a lot more RAM. And actually, Java, well, it needs some memory for the JVM to run. Our application needs to run somewhere, so it's 50 megabytes, and well, we gave the entire program around 150 megabytes of heap. So well, this is what we got. And it actually starts scanning, and it it works quite well. But now we got a little bit of RAM free, so we can do more with it. We can start to extract those frames from that strip file. This is what we got. So how do we identify a frame from this? We have our little red dot on top of there. That's our cursor or whatever you like in our image file. So we need to find those holes, because if we know where the holes are, we know where the frame is. So we start searching, 1,000 pixels. Well, when we don't find anything, we move over a little bit more, 1,000 pixels again. And then we find something that's white. White is good, because a hole is non-existent, and well, that would leave up a nice white hole. So we see if it's a hole. If it's a hole, it's good. Oh. And when we know if it's a hole, then we can find the center of the hole. Great. And when we have the center of the hole, we can actually figure out where the frame is. This is a little bit oversimplified because, well, if the strip is a little bit crooked in there, you would see a little bit of variation in there. So we actually try to figure out a little bit more holes, about 7 or something. And that way we have a nice average, and then we can rotate it a little bit. And, well, we then got more. So if we know 1 or 7, we know where all the frames are and just extract those. All is fine until you get these kinds of deteriorated films. A little algorithm that we thought up just now doesn't work in all the cases. So let's highlight one. As you can see, we have additional holes because the film has degraded or something, or maybe they thought of, well, maybe something black is not cool. Let's make the transition between the holes white or transparent. So we get these kinds of films. So how do we solve that? Again, our little pointer there. We see if it's a hole. It's a hole, it's white, and it's square. Cool. It has the approximate width, but it's way too high. So this is not a hole what we are looking for. So we just move over, and the application is smart enough to see that little bit of yellow as not white. So, well, it really starts to search for pure white. So again, we found a hole. And if we found a hole, then we can search again. And well, it has the correct width, and this time the correct height. So we know where our frame is. This is actually single-layered because the hole is on top of the frame. But that doesn't matter for the application. If that fails, what can we do now? We can actually start to search for transitions between frames. A blue sky with a building, well, that's cool because that blue stops and then, well, it starts to come black. So we know where the bottom of the frame is. Well, that way we can a little bit extrapolate because, well, we try to minimize the blackness of the frame. So that way we get it as well. Well, if this doesn't work either, well, we could think up of more ways to do this, but, well, we could also do this manually. So open the file, click on a top left corner of a frame, and then, well, extrapolate every other frame. So that works as well. So what did we learn here? First off, disk space, it's cheap, but it's not that cheap. Because a raw file is 560 megabytes, well, we'd convert that into a PNG file. PNG is a lossless format, so that's good enough for us. And it's not a proprietary format anymore. We can open it on any computer or any software that that we want. And a frame file is around 4.5 megabytes, also a PNG file. So this doesn't add up too much, except we use 72 frames per minute of film and 1,080 frames per minute of film as well. So this adds up to 10 gigabytes of raw files per minute of film. Well, the films are not that long. They usually run about 3 minutes or something, and then the cassette is done. But hey, it adds up. So speed. A Raspberry Pi is not known for its huge speed. So when we first tried to convert our big 560 megabytes file into a PNG file, we were using Image.io, which comes standard from Java, and was actually quite slow to do this. It took around 4.2 seconds to convert a bitmap file to a PNG, and that's a 10 megapixel file. So that's not even close to what we are trying to do in our strip file, because our strip file is 86 megapixels. So that's a lot larger. So we're actually trying to see if there were more libraries out there. And we found JDaily, but although it was quite fast, it wasn't what we needed, because it was using an internal buffer as well. So we had the initial problem again of 2 × 560 megabytes. So that one fell off, although it was a little bit faster. But Object Planet was using a stream, and well, that's cool, because that doesn't require any additional memory. So we used that. And again, it sped up only almost 50 times, two times, sorry. And the API for Image.io is a single line, and for Object Planet is almost the same. It's two lines, but well, who cares? Who's counting? Another thing that we learned is convenience methods. A buffered image has a getRGB value for an X and Y coordinate, exactly what we need. Cool. Only it returns one integer, because it's three shorts in there. So that's an option. But well, either you need to do some bit shifting to get the correct values, or you can use a nice convenient method that would do that for you. Well, this is not the way we want to do this. We also can get a little bit deeper into our buffered image and get the raster out of there. And on that raster, we can call, again, getPixel with an X and Y coordinate, but this time with an integer array of 3. And that integer array of 3 will be filled with the RGB values. So we can just call in an array at .0 and get the red value out of there. So this is a lot faster. This is, I believe, 25% faster if you do it this way than the convenience method. And on the Raspberry Pi, with trying to extract the frames taking about 5 seconds, well, this speeds it up a lot. Also, threading. Well, we first written the application just as a single thread, and well, we start to process the frame. And process, I mean, try to figure out where the frame is and extract that to a new buffered image that we can write to disk, and then write it to disk, and then the next frame. As you can see, we're not doing a lot of with the CPU here, because when we're writing to disk, the CPU is almost idle. So we split it up a little bit. So we first try to extract the first frame, write it to disk, and already start to find out the next frame. And only when the first frame is done writing, we then start to look for the third frame. And this is done because if we are doing this, the write process takes about 2 times as long as to find the frame. It would build up frames, and then we're running out of memory again. And you will see that shortly. So this is our first application. Got around 700 megabytes, 800 megabytes left to play with. So our strip is loaded into memory, 560 megabytes. We need that. Our first frame that we extracted, and our second frame. And then Java needs a little bit more of memory. So we're now left with a little bit left of memory, but not that much, so we can fit in another image. So this is good, and this is what we want. So we can actually start scanning. And when the scanning is done, when the file doesn't change anymore for a number of periods and has a minimal size, we can start to extract the frames. And well, this way, the scanner is busy, and the Raspberry Pi is busy, and we're not doing anything. So now we have our frames in there. So we use FFmpeg to actually combine those frames into a nice movie. FFmpeg is a little bit of movie target about the API. That changes a little bit from each version to each version, but well, some good documentation is out there. So this is our result. You saw it in the beginning of the film. You see a little bit of artifacts in there. It could be dust or scratches on the movie itself. It's a little bit unstable because, well, it's a handhold thing, but you keep it right here. So we need to fix that. So we need to clean it up a little bit. There is a scripting language, AVI Synth, that would allow you to do this. But as much as I love programming, I don't like programming my movies. So movie editing in scripting language, not my cup of tea. Luckily, French dude created Film 9. There's his website. It's a nice and memorable website. So you can get it there. And actually what it does is create a user interface. And well, you can do this. On the left side, you see our raw movie. And on the right side, we see our cleaned up one. So a lot more stable, a little bit better color, a little bit sharper, a lot more pleasing to the eye. So our final step is just to enjoy the movie. And now I have some time for questions with the Bitbox.